What's up, you filthy casuals? Welcome to the Casual Shenanigans Drinking Cast. I'm Jerem Gaming, one of your hosts, and I'm joined by the not-so-evil Evil Viking 13, currently enjoying Mexicoma.
And a Hellraiser.
Hellraiser IPA. We are also joined by Wildcard, Joel.
Heyo!
And we're joined by Debbie.
Debbie's too drunk to even talk.
She's not quite hugging a chip bag drunk.
We'll get there.
I forgot she did that. I'm sorry, I'm totally laughing at your wife. That's really funny.
Oh, was that, she just saw the braid.
No, she was leaning, like holding the chip bag. I was like, what is going on?
And we're also joined by the wives and John.
Hey, John.
Hey, guys.
All right. So, tonight...
John's first words in the podcast, actually. A really, really inappropriate, hey, yeah.
He's so excited about it.
Please don't find me.
So, we delayed the podcast this week because Thursday, H1Z1 came out. We're like, we're going to play it Thursday, and then we can talk about it this weekend. Did anyone actually play H1Z1?
What actually happened on Thursday?
Well, what actually happened was it was supposed to go live at, what, 1 p.m.?
Yes.
Okay, what happened around, like, noonish?
Delayed.
Well, they said it'll be going live in 2 hours. So I thought, well, am I on the wrong time zone? Like, and then about an hour later, it was like, it'll be going live in 3 hours. And then you guys started telling me on Twitter, apparently they were having, what type of issues were they having?
Just testing server bugs.
Okay, like the last minute rush.
Yeah, wasn't, so, and then getting it uploaded to the stream and all that.
So it finally, when did it officially go live? Like 6 p.m.?
5:30
p.m. Eastern. Yeah. And then,
7 o'clock.
No. Well, it doesn't matter when it actually went live because no one could get in.
Yeah, like, I bought it at 5:30, but
probably 10 people played it Thursday evening. I mean, it was nobody.
And they were all streaming on Twitch.
Because there were 200 game servers and one login server. One. Which, again, they said, well, what did they say, Dave? What about there's only so much you can test for?
Yeah, I need to find this blog post. I believe it was by one of the Battlefield 4 server architects where he basically said that launch day server connections are essentially a legitimate DDoS. Like, it's your actual customer is just smashing you with traffic. And you can mitigate some of that by buying a lot of extra hardware for a lot of extra money, but at a certain point, there's just no more returns, and you're going to be spending millions of dollars to let a few hundred thousand more people in. And really, the best solution is to prepare for a large amount and then just kind of have everyone else be patient. Otherwise, you're just wasting money.
I think it's a bad plan to plan for gamers to be patient.
Yeah, that's the weak link, I think, in the plan.
No one, I don't think no one is patient. I mean, John Smedley, he's the creative director, or... No, he's the head of Sony Online Entertainment?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was getting some really nasty tweets on Thursday from people who, like, were really upset they couldn't play a game was worth, like...
They couldn't play the day one of an early access alpha. There's problems? What?
Well, I mean, it had a smoother launch than most AAA games in the past year that have multiplayer. Because within 12 hours, you could log in and play on a server. You might get disconnected or kicked, though it might be a few issues. But you could actually log in and play, unlike, say, Drive Club, where we're going on 3 months and they're just pretending, like... That whole part of the game doesn't exist anymore. Like, I mean, there's been way worse launches in the past year. I mean, most games now are getting patched for weeks and weeks and weeks, and I'm sure it's going to get patches. It got a patch today, but you could actually play it within like 12 hours.
It's being patched right now, actually.
Probably. Yes.
You know, what might have been helpful is if they just launched it actually at midnight.
It makes no difference these days.
The people will just stay out. That's
there were people. Multiple people had taken off of work.
Dave, what time were you up on launch day?
The servers went live at 2:30, like actually playable at 2:30.
A.M. or P.M.?
A.M.
On so Friday, the day after.
Yeah. Friday.
Yeah. So you were up until 2:30 a.m. to play.
Log in.
So the midnight thing would not work.
Yeah.
Because Dave.
Yeah, there's a lot of Daves out there.
But maybe that would have, I mean, it might have been just that many people and maybe a little bit less.
Yeah, but that's the thing is they can say, well, there's just no way to anticipate this. But if every major game release goes, there was no way to anticipate this. Someone has to be anticipating it. Like, I think it's not, there's no way to anticipate it. I think that's the PR line. What they're saying is, like Dave said, it would cost a lot of money to deliver a smooth experience. I think they're making a conscious decision a lot of the time to have the game break the first day because so many people are joining that it's a DDoS, and they're totally okay with that. But if you can't say that as a PR
line, right.
You can't say, tough guys, get over it. But
it might be one of those things where it's like, the game costs $50 million total for its 2.5-3 year lifetime to make. and it'll take $4 million to make sure everyone can get on launch day. Or we can spend $500,000 and, like, most people can get in on launch day.
Whereas Call of Duty, they'll spend $4 million. Exactly. And we're totally making these numbers up.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
They'll spend $4 million because they're going to make $700 million,
yeah,
and that's all they care about. Debbie is holding a hat over her dog's eyes.
It's not just any hat.
It's a handmade hat, that's true. And then there was also a day one controversy with H1Z1.
Yes.
Despite them talking many times, or Debbie, what have they been saying about pay to win throughout this process? Debbie is our Dave. Like, Dave knows everything about DayZ and we don't learn about it. Dave just tells us. That's Debbie for H1Z1.
Yeah, Debbie, this is your time to shine.
Well, they've been saying it's not going to be pay to win. That means you can't buy ammo, guns, food, water, anything that would give you an advantage in the game. However, in a way, you can buy them. But it's available to everyone on the server that is within
you
running
can
distance.
Get them in the loot drop.
The airdrops.
So you think that's pay to win?
I don't think so, no.
It's pay to change the balance of the server.
Exactly.
For sure.
It does a lot of changes and whatnot, so.
Yeah, but as long as you have weapons that are, like, easily found, like,
yeah,
I found
it's the same weapons that can be found
in
the game.
It's like, yeah, you can get a weapon for not hunting 10 minutes.
You're just throwing a wild card in the game.
Me and this random guy online, just last night, it dropped, and we killed the guy, and we stole his weapons.
Sweet. And to their credit, since, like, they had...
I felt like Lost. Have you seen the Lost episode when the cargo dropped?
Yeah.
It was like that. It was like, I was like, oh my god! We're all running towards it! We saw other people come in the woods, and it was like Hunger Games.
Well, that's what happens in Rust. In Rust, in the original version of Rust, there's, like, drops would come in, you'd see just, like, swarms of people running towards it to beat each other to death with rocks. But to Sony's, or I guess Sony Online Entertainment, does the studio have its own name that worked on this?
SOE is a separate Sony studio. Yeah, it's
okay.
But they don't have
sub studios that were working on this.
No, this is just the overarching SOE studio. Yeah.
So they, to their credit, they are offering refunds for anyone who's upset about that.
Until Monday.
Now, does that get rid of your copy in Steam, or does it just give
you
your money back? Because the refunds are not through Steam; it's through their website.
No, they're communicating with Steam, and you initiate the refund ideally through Sony. But then Sony has Steam approve it, so it is through Steam, yeah.
So they will take your copy back. Okay.
Yeah, so for the airdrops, they actually talked about the balancing today. The problem was that on day one, first of all, most people hadn't realized that there was supposed to be a slight chance of guns and ammo in the airdrops. That was very briefly discussed just a few days ago, but it kind of, no one really noticed until on the first night streams, the airdrops that came in were dropping within about 100 meters of the person calling it in. And every drop had ammo and guns.
So they have balancing issues.
So what they're saying is it's currently like 150 to 300 meters where it comes in. They're saying it's going to be like 700 to 1300 after the balance. There's going to be a lower chance of weapons. And the plane's going to move slower and travel further over the map so more people can see it coming in.
And I think when I played last time, we heard this sound for a very long time. James could hear it too. I didn't see the plane, but you hear this. Like, I was like, oh, what the heck?
Yeah.
It was a long time, so it's like, the way people are making it out, like, it dropped it right at the feet. It's bullcrap. It's not.
No,
it took a long time.
Day one, it did. Like, the original version of the game, it was dropping.
So they already did a patch before, after that?
There have been, like, four patches, like, today, yes.
Oh, okay.
No.
They're doing a really good job.
Okay, so I was going to say, if that was the same, I was like, then did they have a patch? I was like, it took a while. Like, it was in the air for, like, probably, like, 2 or 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm. They're also adding a lot of heat to the airdrops, so any activity... Like, where it drops, it's generating a lot of heat on the heat map, which means zombies are going to be more attractive.
Can you explain that system really quick when you say heat?
Yeah, the heat is just any place where there's a lot of activity, so anything from stepping on, like, just running around, it generates heat. If you're fighting with people, it generates more heat, so more zombies are attracted to the
area.
That's
pretty cool.
If you're exploding things, that's, like, obviously a ton. Like, you're just burning your face off.
And I've noticed that working. Like, any towns where a couple people would show up and start fighting with each other, you're running around, like, hacking each other to bits... zombies, like, if there was 3 or 4 zombies when they got into town, by the time they were done beating each other up, there could be, like, 10 or 15 zombies.
Yep.
That's a cool
switch. I do like the zombies that ones that would just slowly walk after you, and then one would just, like, slowly walk and just be like, and just start running. I was like, holy crap!
Yeah.
I jumped on top of the man,
our impressions. So, like, what's everyone's first impressions? Obviously, none of us have played it for more than a couple hours, but...
My very first impression was jumping in the game. I got into a car, and I'm like, sweet, I got a car! And then I got disconnected from the server. I didn't know that. I couldn't get out of the car, and it was broken, so I was just sitting there looking around. As I saw this one guy look, he's like, looks in the window, and he's just like, can I get in too? And then he's like, just wanders away. I was like, help me!
So Joel can't figure out the controls, gets stuck in a car. All right, that's Joel's impression.
Yeah.
That is a problem we're having if the server goes down, and they are going down frequently right now just because of issues on them. But if they go down, you don't necessarily know the server's down. You just know
that... It popped up, I think, really quick one time. But
sometimes it doesn't, though. Sometimes it just everything stops responding. Like it has on DayZ before. We'll go where we suddenly... There's a huge lag picking up items. The lag gets worse and worse and worse. And then everyone's like, hey, I can't pick up anything now. And then usually you get the server disconnect a couple minutes after that. So it appears to be a similar thing on H1Z1. But so, Joel, what do you think about, like... Not that we want to compare this to H1Z1, and there's a lot of clickbait articles
to DayZ.
Or to DayZ, sorry. There's a lot of clickbait articles going around, like, is this the DayZ killer? Two games can exist at the same time. It doesn't have to kill anything. Like, I mean, Battlefield isn't the Call of Duty killer, and Call of Duty isn't the Battlefield killer, and Titanfall didn't kill anything. Like, there are multiple games that can exist.
Titanfall
so,
killed itself.
Ignoring that, we do need to compare it to DayZ a little bit because of they're both trying to accomplish similar goals along slightly divergent paths. Yeah. They're not opposites of each other, but they are variations.
Yeah, I mean, it's okay to say, like, DayZ killer in a sense, because it's not, it's, you know, it'd be the same as you know, like, Titanfall, like Call of Duty. I think, like, the latest Call of Duty multiplayer is freaking awesome. Like, and they have a lot of similar things from Titanfall, you know, like the jetpack boosting around and stuff. It's just super slick, you know, and you'd be like, okay, if this one game is just a little bit better at doing the same thing, yeah, I'm probably not going to go back to the other just because... Mm-hmm. This one does it better.
At the same time, like, Call of Duty wasn't a Battlefield 4 killer. Battlefield 4 was a Battlefield 4 killer.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, those games are very, very different, you know what
I
mean? Right, so, my second impression, because I played for about 2 hours, and the map was stable, other than the rain just looking like 1990s rain, like, it was
it's
bad.
And it won't stop raining. It won't
stop. It's for the Pacific Northwest. That's reasonable.
I love the rain. I wish the game would be raining constantly, but just a good rain. I love it. Okay, the sound effects, going inside a building and hear it rain on the... I was
so
like,
good.
And then the sound effects, you walk, like, you hear, like, even, like, a hammer, everything, it has that echo and, like, reverb to it, like, I don't know, being... I was sold. I was like, this is awesome. Like, that's what I wanted in DayZ. I want that immersion feeling like I'm actually in the environment. Like, attached to the ground. Like, actually walking around. And that was just... That was awesome. Like, controls are smooth. They worked really well. Like, other than, you know, the zombies kind of glitching around right now. But, like, it was fun. I had a blast. But the lighting is awesome. Going in a house, like, using a flashlight. Mm-hmm. Not being able to see anything. That was cool.
And they're actually adding more lighting effects in the future. Right now, there's no divider between interior and exterior lighting. They're going to do, like, you can do in CryEngine, where you can create a light, like, sub-box, an invisible template.
Yeah, so it kind of, like, changes a little bit when you go in.
When you get close to it, it actually fades in more detailed lights for the interior. So the interior will get its, like, own shading separate from the global world, and as you move from house to house, you have darker interior.
It was also, me and this random guy, we explored this, like factory or something like that. It was just so cool. It was just pitch dark, but the flashlight worked really well. His flashlight worked well. It was really fun, like, looting and searching for stuff. And the amount of crafting they have is insane. Like, just day one, they got like 1,000 different things you can do. Mm-hmm. I only figured out a few of them, like, kind of by accident. I made berry juice with water. I was actually trying to eat the berries, but I clicked another button and I crafted something. But it's just I'm sold. I mean, their world's pretty small. It's not like insanely detailed yet. But
so
they're 60 building
64 square kilometers.
I don't know. I honestly don't know.
It feels fine,
but like, it's still pretty big. It took me. Yeah. I couldn't find James, so it's still.
Well, think about that.
Just no. I'm not worried about world size. I'm not worried about world size. They're gonna make it massive. I'm just worried. I want to be able to play the game and it work well.
Yeah.
You know? Even the jumping, it's janky. But it still works when you press spacebar.
Yeah, that's one of those immediate comparisons you can make to DayZ. DayZ is simulating a lot of things. H1Z1 simulates a lot less, but the end result is H1Z1 feels much smoother and more intuitive for a lot of things. Like, from moment one, jumping works. Punching stuff in the face works. Like, I mean, most of the really simple actions...
Dude, I was kind of amazed that it actually had, like, a third punch. Mm-hmm. We, like, punch, and it does this, like, mega swing. I was like, yeah!
But, like, I was actually able to punch zombies, knock them to the ground, and run away. Like, in DayZ, that pretty much never happens, because the melee system, it's just broken.
I told Dave, I think they're on the opposite spectrums of development. DayZ started out with a pre-made map that they're updating, you know? They started with this giant world that I think is very detailed and... pretty realistic in some sense, right? Like, the topographical map. H1 started, they have a small map. They don't have that pre-built for them. They started with a good base engine. That's what I think. So I'm excited that the world's going to get bigger, but I'm just excited that not every patch is going to break the core game.
Right.
So when DayZ gets there, I think it's going to be really good, but it's the fact that it's going to take forever for them to just keep the core game working.
Right.
And so it's always back and forth. But, yeah, no, I mean, it was fun. It was
It felt like Left 4 Dead.
It feels good to play a game at like 60 FPS. Yes. And as I'm, yes, it makes it a does, big yes. difference. Just
like, I don't think they don't have anti-aliasing in the game, because I noticed that like on the
they don't,
they have post effect. Yeah,
yeah, because the power lines and stuff.
Not to like try
bad.
4K master race here. I don't notice any aliasing issues.
Even on 1440p, the
you know what I mean, like the power lines.
The power lines
pretty ultra, but it was,
the power lines do a lot of.
You remember, like for an MMO, it looks great.
Yeah, you know exactly.
For a shooter, it doesn't look very good. But
see, like, I know Dave would reject, but it's like, you know, he goes for the hyper realistic like bullet physics and stuff. But I would gladly remove that, since you can't really enjoy that in DayZ right now because it's so laggy.
Right.
Then I'm just like, maybe put that in later when you got the system under control. But it's like, I'm not gonna notice any of that crap if it's actually working fine.
DayZ has a more ambitious vision, but H1Z1 is much smoother right now. Like, you can tell they SOE has way more people to throw at stuff like UI menus and stuff. Like, they have a launcher that tells you information about the game. Like, it tells you that there's patches and there's
and where you can buy t-shirts.
Yeah, where you can buy swag. But it, like,
how many
shows
people are streaming?
When you log in, there are like, it has an actual good splash screen with music, and it feels creepy. And when you go to look through a server, they have icons showing you instead of the server's name. Friendlies only. You can't hurt people. Blah blah blah. It's all lies. They have actual icons showing you this server shows this and this.
They don't have the rules.
No, they have PVE, like where you can't kill other
people. Yeah.
No, I'm saying the legend is there on the screen.
Yeah.
Is what you're
saying. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, they.
I played a PVE one, and I just to be used to playing DayZ. I was like, oh, I'm friendly. They're like, guys, I can't hit you. I was like, oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, we all pals.
It's fun. It's cool.
Dude, I love
it. It's
so
option.
Much fun.
I wouldn't
like,
mind if DayZ had that option, just so you can
ourselves.
Enjoy the game without having, like, every person you see wants to kill you just because they're bored. Like, they've been running for 3 hours, and they just want to hurt. Because
I think the DayZ experience is lost. I don't think it's ever coming back. Whether the game is super awesome at the end, you're never going to get that crowd when it first started. It's not.
I think the glory days of the mod are never coming back.
Just because it was so new, it was like, oh man,
I finally found the final game could still be amazing. But yeah, I think it's kind of like Battlefield 4 right now.
Be like that again.
But it doesn't matter because of all the people.
I played that today too. It was pretty good.
Debbie, what did you think? You've been really excited about H1Z1.
Oh my word. I actually had a chance to sit down and play it for a good half hour today. And so far, all I did was I crafted a bow, and I stalked a deer for a good 20 minutes, and I killed it.
Was it a good time?
It was a great time.
Would you say the deer animations are pretty dang
awesome? Deer.
Like, when they're not, like, glitching or skipping away.
I haven't seen any of that yet.
Dude, it looks awesome.
And the
I was like,
deer is
they
amazing.
They, like turn and stuff like that and bank. It was, like, really impressive. I'm like, the game is kind of blowing me away from, like, just... Second day.
Polished.
Yeah.
Polished.
It's like how polished it is,
for
just
alpha,
from what
I
it
think
is.
It's pretty polished.
It's not like, oh, we have a running animation that's absolutely hideous. It's not amazing, but it works. It's like, I press forward, I'm going forward.
Yeah, it feels like Rust, honestly, like with the animation stuff. Like, it's a little cartoony, it's not super realistic, but it works fine. Like, it's totally fine for this style they're going for.
Yeah.
Let's talk about zombies. I think these zombies are way better than DayZ's for a couple reasons. I like that in DayZ, it feels like if you get within a certain perimeter of a zombie and make any noise or like do any alerting things, the zombies lock onto you pretty quick, and they're pretty hard to get rid of. In DayZ. They're pretty aggressive. In H1Z1, it feels like the zombies can see you and just not be interested. If you're not doing anything interesting, like if you just walk past nice and
slow. This will follow you slowly.
They might follow you slowly, but then they lose interest pretty quick. Like, you actually have to be aggressive really near them. You have to make
Jeremiah,
noise.
Just a note, right now they are in easy mode, as they call it.
Okay.
They are not turning up the aggro just because the server was lagging so much, they had to turn down the zombie aggro by like,
that makes sense.
A lot.
They do feel kind of easy.
Yeah, they're very easy.
I mean, if they start chasing you, because like with the heat map, more of them will show up. They can get enough that it's serious. All the pitter patter you're hearing is Debbie's cat is going insane right now.
Dave, the question on that is: have you been to the police station yet?
Joel, what you should be asking me is, have I been to a town yet?
Oh, never.
Or
have
I
been to a town yet?
Briefly.
Are you serious?
Dave.
Dave. I told you, I was like, DayZ's finished, Dave will physically not be able to play the game because it will be too much simulation that he'll be like, he'll be in the woods, never see anyone, he'll never be able to go into town.
And I'm going to love every second of it, too.
Yeah, I know, but we'll miss you, Dave, because we're like, man, we lost
the miss you. I've actually only found one large town so far. It was kind of cool. I was picking berries because I was low on hunger, and like in DayZ, like, you see the sprinting zombies first, and you're like, wait, what are those zombies doing? And then you kind of, like, lead in front of them, and you're like, oh, crap, there's people. So I watched him go to the town that I had just passed, and the server I was on, the loot was just not spawning, so I was about to actually just give it up. But I saw the guys running into the town, and I flanked around to the opposite side to avoid running into them. Looted a few houses, but once again, the loot wasn't spawning correctly. So actually what happened was I was going for the grocery store, which is kind of near the edge of town on my side. And then I saw like another zombie train down, like going down the side of the building. I'm like, oh, nope, time to call it. And I just left town.
And you die so quick in the game right now because you like lose health pretty quick.
Yes.
But, yeah, you starve to death really quick.
Did you see the guy who did a test?
20 minutes.
Yeah, 20
just
minutes.
Just standing there.
You die. But anyways, I went to the police station, Dave.
Mm-hmm.
There was 3 cop cars right there. I hopped into one of them. I almost had all the stuff to have a cop car. I just needed a battery.
Joel, why wasn't that texted immediately?
I got a cop car the other day. It was on fire, but it was still drivable. Like, the tires really? Were on fire. Yeah, I drove it up the hill and took the spark plugs out. Me and another guy stuck them in a truck. And we had a truck. It only went, like, 20 miles an hour. But it worked. It was ours.
But it was... Yeah, I got in the police station. I was like... I immediately felt like I was playing Fallout New Vegas.
Yeah.
Like, it really feels like I'm playing Fallout New Vegas. Like, it was just cool. Like, it's like, it's not realistic-looking world, but it feels like Fallout New Vegas world, where it's like, it has essence of realism, but it also has just good, plain old fun. Like,
it's not,
cool,
it's not realistic, but it's still immersive.
Okay, what, at Yates Hotel? Was supposed to be Bates Hotel? I was like,
awesome.
You get what it is, and I was like, okay, I explored every inch of it.
More,
it was so much fun.
It feels more gamey. DayZ doesn't feel gamey a lot of the time. Like, again, with, like, the UI and stuff, DayZ looks like someone typed Times New Roman. Like, I mean, it feels like a lot of it's just hacked together.
But the thing is, what they're trying to do is give a game experience of a zombie. Like, when people think of Walking Dead, I want to have that experience of going to that town.
Right.
Well, DayZ probably not going to give you that. It's going to be a very different experience. This game will probably give you that experience, because they're, like, trying to make that experience. Like, hey, you want a town that looks like that? We'll make that town.
This is, like, the ideal experiences will be, like, for DayZ, the final realized vision will be you can have your campsite out in the woods, you can have gardens, you can have, you know, your shack or your shed or your cave, you've got all your gear stored up, you have loot drops other places, and you're just surviving. H1Z1 is you want to get all your friends together, hop in and, like, run around, find food, kill zombies, you know, drive cars through crowds of zombies, and just have, like, fun.
Okay.
I mean, impression I'm getting.
From the zombies, like, and, you know, it's like, you can tell, like, just from playing, you're like... This game's gonna go somewhere. You can just tell. Like, even from the zombies. But
it's
imagine this. Like, I can't wait to go into some town and then just double cross all of you by chucking something that, like, makes all the zombies appear, lock you in some room, be like, see you, suckers. And be like, oh, no.
Joel, like, you realize that you're gonna see us again, though, right? We're not just randoms you ran into. Like, I'm gonna betray this whole group. Oh, crap, these are my actual friends. Oh, whoops.
Oh, something else that happened today. I was in a house loading, and a guy came in right behind me. I turned around. He was right there. He punched me in the face. We had a punching fight for a good, like, 5 minutes. We were pretty low on health, and we were getting really bored because we didn't have weapons. We were just punching each other. Like, all right, this is bored. So I did the hand gesture animation, like, you're raising your hand like, hi. And we both just did it at the same time, went our separate ways.
We just got
really bored of fighting each other. It was just wasn't there.
Boy, this actually hurts.
Why did I do this?
Like, this is boring. Let's just go.
Were you punching him in the head?
Yeah, just punching him in the
head. It took that long?
Yeah.
So I've knocked people out with like 5 good hits to the head and they go down. I had a guy trying to shoot me with a bow and arrow earlier. I did the DayZ thing. You just strafe back and forth and they can't aim fast enough.
Yeah.
And then I just danced around and punched him in the head. He kept trying to use his bow still. Like, I don't... Bows aren't close quarter weapons. But
he was going to 360 no-scope you with the bow.
He did pull out an axe, but he had to give that up. Because, like, I was punching him so he would recoil, and he couldn't get the axe back up in time for me before I hit him again.
Nice.
But I was able to knock him out, but then I crouched over and I was trying to take all his stuff. He had, like, a couple guns. And then someone shot me with an arrow. And then I saw on the kill screen, zombies swarmed them and, like, someone killed them.
Have you picked up a backpack yet?
Have I what?
Have you gotten a backpack in the
game? Only my first night when the servers were just wrecked.
Okay.
So,
I got the backpack. I was like, James, why is it so satisfying to have a backpack? He's like, because you know you can shovel everything into that sucker. I was like, but I'm not even like that super into loot. But he's like, it's just it's ingrained in all of us.
Now, Joel,
well,
give you
options.
Were you and James able to meet up?
No, we didn't have a meet up, but we both had hilarious stories. As I heard James like fighting some random person. It was really funny.
I had an amazing first encounter, or first death, I guess you could say. I met a bunch of people my first night. The spawns seem to be a little bit limited right now, so I had people like spawning in front of me, even though I tried to go out of the way. But I finally came across a guy, and I was about to die of thirst, and he's like, hey man, I'm dying, I can't find any water. I was like, oh, me too. He's like, well, here, you want my stuff? I was like, well, I mean, I'm dying too, you want some of my stuff? Like, we're both just about to die. I kept noticing, like, he had a friend who was, like, crouched behind this tree off in the distance. I was like, well, he might be dying. Maybe his friend, like, is going to try to get me with all the loot and bring it back to him or something. Like, maybe he's just trying to get my guard down. So I was like, well, you know, I'm not going to make it either. Like, does your friend want some loot? And he turns around, like, my friend? And the guy is sprinting towards him with a knife in his hand. He goes, oh, that's not my friend. Oh, he's trying to kill me. And then he immediately stabs both of us. Like, we're so low on health, we just both die instantly. It's like, oh, that's not my friend.
Honestly, like, I get, I'm not trying to rag on DayZ, but the melee working is a big deal. Like, when you don't really have any weapons, working melee...
It was fun, yeah.
It feels really good because it's actually useful right now. You can actually sneak up on someone, sucker punch them a couple times and take their stuff. Where in DayZ, like, you might get a one-hit kill, like, knockout on them, or you might the other night.
But the melee's not... It's just not fun to use.
DayZ, it's so broken right now. It's not tactile. It just doesn't work. Would you agree, Dave?
I mean, yeah, it's not finished yet, so it's...
I know it's not finished, but yeah. I'm saying, this isn't finished either. So this unfinished melee, I think, works way better.
And I definitely miss in DayZ when it was the chivalry style. Like, that's not back yet.
Yeah.
So it's still cursor-based, and it still feels really disconnected. When... In the beginning, it was laggy, but at least when you saw things connect, they actually connected.
Yeah, yeah.
Every game with melee should just rent chivalry's
melee
system.
The way
DayZ
works,
just license it.
DayZ does not work very well when you're moving doing melee. That's the big thing.
Well,
like,
nothing,
you have to stop.
Nothing
in it's
DayZ
like Resident
works well
Evil.
When you're moving because the low server FPS.
Yeah, exactly. But it's like, it sucks when you have to, like, run, stop, line up your axe, hit. Move around, stop, line up your axe, hit. It should be just like you move and, you know, hit.
And that's why, like I was saying, when it was still sweep-based, no, in standalone before, they're currently still rebuilding the melee system, and when it was still based on your object visually hitting
things.
Have
they now rebuilt it like 5 times now?
This is the second time, yeah.
Maybe the second time.
Yeah,
they had the original version, then they did the swipe version. Now
well,
they
disable stuff occasionally.
Yeah, they turned it off entirely. They had like a very simple cursor-based system, and it was awful, so they rebuilt a placeholder system. I knew it was going to be 4 or 5 months before the final one was going to be even like in the first version.
Yeah.
So we're in like the middle placeholder one. But what I was saying was, in the beginning, when it was still that sweep based, you could actually time attacks when you were moving. But now that it's cursor based again, that's basically impossible to do right now.
I hope one day they'll get that. And I think it's not just are they going to be able to develop it, is are they going to have someone in the team that recognizes that's the what they need to go with. You know what I mean? But if they have someone that's just the hardcore original mod, like, no, this just works. This is how it is. I'm like, they're never going to get to that point.
Right.
So, I have total confidence they're going to get to the end of development and they'll actually get some smooth thing. But what that is, I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah,
if it's
I don't
be
think
just
they know
as,
at this point.
I don't think they'll ever get to a point where the melee is, like, actually working like you'd expect it to work in a game, you know?
I think H1Z1's release is either going to push the DayZ dev team.
Yeah.
Or it's going to, like... make them very sad. I don't know. Because, I mean, Sony, they're Bohemia, it doesn't matter how many copies DayZ sold, Bohemia will never be able to keep up with SOE.
I think that the all the DayZ Killer articles are extra funny because the developers are actually, like, I wouldn't say, like, they're best friends, but it's a very small development.
They don't have that attitude about it.
Exactly.
Or
but
publicly.
People are creating this dichotomy when the developers are like, no, like, we're excited to try it. Like,
I think where it comes from is the people that just... are so freaking diehard DayZ that are like, it can't do any wrong, that's wrong.
Well,
it's just alpha. I'm like, yeah. But like, have you seen development? Like, they're still working on the running. It's a year. Like, they did it 5 times. Like, that's where I'm going. I don't know if they're going to get to a point where it's going to be a
DayZ has
game.
Development problems.
There's no way they can hit their initial timelines.
They just can't.
Their art, their assets and stuff like that is awesome, phenomenal, but it's when it comes to their animation.
Hey, is that what I thought you said?
I heard that too.
Art? Their assets. What did you think?
Phenomenal.
Phenomenal.
That's what Joel cares about in his survival game.
Yes.
Well, that's the thing is, I think because this is a kind of a new genre, people feel like there can be only one.
Yeah.
No one's like, is Dragon Age Inquisition a Skyrim killer? No.
I saw articles.
Really?
Like, yeah.
All right, most people don't think that, though.
But, yeah.
Because you're like, hey, or, you know.
Such clickbait.
Yeah, do you want to play Divinity Original Sin? You want to play Dragon Age Origins? You want to play The Witcher? Most people want to play all of them because they're fun. Like, I mean, that's if you like the game, play the game. I plan on playing DayZ and H1Z1. Right now, I'm going to play more H1Z1 because it's new and it's smooth and it's polished. And for me, DayZ is fun once a month or so. We can hop in and have some good old DayZ fun and hop out before all the broken stuff really starts to annoy you. Like, if I had to play DayZ every night, I couldn't do it.
Mm.
But H1Z1, I probably can't either because there's just not enough to do at the moment. But right now, it's the casual. It's filling that casual
slot.
Maybe
why Dave loves it so much is because he hasn't gotten to actually see the other features in DayZ that don't work. Because he's no bed in the woods. It's like, dude, the trees look fine, man. Crawling works
Dave
fine.
Dave got to try eating people for the first time the other night.
We ate a lot of people, actually.
A lot of people. It was tasty. But yeah, anyone have any last thoughts on the first couple hours of H1Z1? We'll obviously check back in later.
Like, you haven't asked me yet.
You've been voicing opinions this entire time. I'm sorry.
Well, I mean, here and there. Yeah.
Okay, Dave.
Go on.
Oh, this is where Dave gets to talk about what he doesn't like.
No, I actually went into it with, like, zero expectations because I didn't want to ride the hype train and I wanted to try to be neutral as much as possible. So I've actually been, I'd say I've been impressed, actually, because I went into it with no expectations. Like, ignoring the launch day issues, which, like I've said before...
For launch day issues, they were minor, though.
It's early access launch. Like, if you don't expect issues, like, I really have pity for you, like, in life, because there's going to be a lot more disappointments coming your way. And I seem to have had really bad luck. I've played about 3.5 actual hours in-game now, and I keep getting really low FPS servers where I've had some... I've been DayZ'd a few times. I've had zombies phase through walls. I've been hit by zombies over 30 feet away and stuff like that. I've gotten a lot of that, but all of that is just a matter of just like DayZ of getting the server FPS down, and it sounds like they're going to have that under control. They're planning on having it under control in the next few days. So ignoring stuff like that that I think they're going to fix pretty quickly, the environment, I think, is definitely not as realistic as DayZ by any means. But it's immersive in a Left 4 Dead way, where it's gamey, right. But it's cool. There's cool places.
Yeah, it's not realistic, but it doesn't have to be. Like, that's not the goal.
Yeah, exactly. Like, they're not going for photorealistic, and that's okay. And I've said it before, I hope they go more stylized. Like, do some more State of Decay style, like, over-the-top zombie movie stuff. Almost.
It could look like TF2 if it was fun. Like, yeah, I don't care. Yeah. I don't care what the style is, as long as it's good and runs smooth and works well. Like, do whatever you want, you know? And which is, I think, kind of the attitude they've taken, because the game, it runs really well.
It does. I did find there's some combination of Ultra settings where you can be running on Ultra, and like you check a few more options, and it goes from 60 FPS to like 14. It's some combination of HDR.
Yeah, it's an optimization hole there.
Yeah, it's like a combination of HDR and ambient occlusion you can hit, and it just like, it's like a, I don't know, like a some sort of loop you hit, and it just destroys your FPS. But once again, it's alpha, that's what you expect.
The best thing we do know with that is they can actually utilize cores, since it's not on the reality.
Is it 64-bit?
Real virtuality. And no, it's 32-bit.
But it can still use more than one core?
It is multi-threaded, at least partially. Yeah, because it's based off of the PlanetSide engine.
Yeah, because PlanetSide does run really well. Mm-hmm.
It didn't in beta, but
yeah.
PlanetSide had some rough moments, but and actually, if you have PlayStation 4, PlanetSide 2's open beta, or I don't know if it's open beta or closed beta, it starts January 20th. If you want to try it out,
oh cool.
What's up, Maya? You want to sneeze on us again? You good?
It's cool. Mine.
Yeah, tell your dog to shush.
The fundamentals in H1Z1 are they're definitely there. The melee combat is pretty great. I hope I can find a server soon where I can actually try it, because all the zombies I've fought so far were either desynced or like completely immobile, like not aggroing at all. So I haven't really had a chance to try melee. And then I've always been so low on health from starving that all my player versus player fights have ended in a single hit. Like I just ragdoll like as soon as the fight starts. I've always been so weak. And of course, both the servers that I've tried in the last few days had the loot spawning problem. So in an hour and a half, I only found 4 water bottles and a bottle of pills.
Now, is it a loot spawning problem, or is it just there's way
you've also been in the woods.
Like,
you say you've only been to one town.
But there's tons of places, like, outside of the big towns that you can find. Like, I found all kinds of big camping locations, cabins, smaller neighborhoods.
Okay.
I just wanted to make sure you actually did go.
No.
There's still canned food under the trees.
I found canned food at a campsite, actually, like, in the middle of the woods. It was really cool. When I say that I've only been to one town, I mean like a large town.
Okay.
Drink up, Joel.
Alright. Thank you for your thoughts, Dave.
I guess that's all my thoughts.
Do you have more thoughts?
Shut up!
That's not what I meant.
Yeah, I'm good for now, I guess.
Okay. I mean, we'll be talking, like, I feel like we all haven't played it a ton to give, like, really in-depth thoughts. And everyone on the internet's giving their thoughts right now, so why do you care what we think?
Oh, I do have actually one last thought on the airdrop issue.
Okay.
I think that they are going to get it more balanced over the next, just a couple of weeks. Like, they're going to keep doing player testing and whatnot. I think that H1Z1, I'd be a lot more comfortable with if they had just kept it black and white, where there are no ways to find weapons outside of finding the world. I'd prefer that, but at least it's not going to stay like it was on launch night.
Right.
So I think it's going to get better to a point where it's almost irrelevant. I just really like it if it was completely irrelevant and they removed it entirely.
No, I completely agree. I think, I wish they would go, hey, crap, we have a billion people wanting to buy this game. Screw it. It's $20 now.
Yes.
When we launch it, it's going to be $40 or whatever.
Yes.
Or
just do that, you know?
If they made a server rule set where they say you can't buy ammos within the airdrops.
It'd be nice if they had, like, maybe on the PvE servers have the air weapons airdropped in. Like, because it doesn't matter. You can't kill each other.
James mentioned that. James, he was like, you could do it on that because it doesn't matter.
And on PvP, it's randomized. You can't call it in and the server decides.
Yeah, I don't know.
But still, like, there's ways they can make it...
Like, it wouldn't even matter if someone else got... If it just landed right at your feet, because it's not like they're going to kill you. They're just going to kill zombies. You know?
CSGO has proven that you do not have to have game balance changing items to monetize your game.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, CSGO has proven that.
And the cool thing is, like, in CSGO...
They've done it twice, with TF2 and CSGO.
Yeah. Because they're a trustworthy company.
And the thing is, okay...
It's a good game, too.
So, having a weapon skin in Counter-Strike, that's pretty cool, right? Like, you kind of keep it with you...
I don't think it's like $500 cool like a lot of people do.
Sure. But maybe like there's a skin that like really fits you, like you like OD green, and there's one for like $10. You're like, okay, the game was like only $10, and I'm gonna play this for 1,000 hours. I'm gonna customize my character to be like me, like things I like. That might be worth it. I think that's even more valuable in a game like H1Z1, where your character is with you for a lot longer, you're doing a lot more traveling, and like you wanna make yourself look unique. I think just cosmetic stuff would be incredibly popular. If that's all there were. They don't need to have the weapons.
I think it almost, you can almost do that. And when it comes to, like, houses and stuff, like, if you wanted, like, I don't know, specific furniture. Let's say, okay, like, even Guild Wars, right? You either buy in-game or you can just use with coins or, like, you can have your own guild. And then you can, like, buy stuff for your, like, home base, which is kind of cool. So that would actually be kind of cool. You could build, so you could have, let's say you have a piece that you build in a cabin. So, people are you guys pointing at each other about booze? Like, you grab bottle, me drink it.
It does look like that.
That's exactly what it was.
I was just asking if you wanted a drink.
Oh. Has anyone actually fired guns in H1Z1 yet? Because I'm curious about the ballistics. Is it hit scan? Do we know yet?
I clicked a gun.
Yeah, I picked up some guns.
They have ballistic drones.
They have ballistics. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
So it's like Battlefield. Battlefield style, probably.
I take that. Like, I honestly,
absolutely.
I think DayZ went overboard. Well, they poured it in the ARMA system. That's why it's so complicated. I think DayZ went overboard in their weapon simulation just because most people won't be able to appreciate all the simulation because
you don't appreciate it directly, but you appreciate the way that it affects the gameplay.
Well, the thing is,
sometimes I love it, but if it
causes lag and delay, just get rid of it. Like,
you can't
appreciate it if all that stuff together combines to slow the server down.
Right,
so
but it's
much.
Not the ballistics that's causing a slow server FPS. The ballistics is one of the lightest calculations that the server's doing. Because there's not that many people firing weapons at a given time in the server.
Yeah, but still, but like, Dan, you were talking about something else. It was saying that it was so low on the list. It was ARMA 3. It was like the way that the AI animates, saying like they can't go behind cover because that's the lowest on AI. It's like, well, how about the other things that tells them, hey, let's get in a Jeep and drive away. Like, let's just get rid of that animation because we all want to go into an area and shoot them. Maybe they can get some of the areas in DayZ and bring those back later. Like things that are
Answer would be
get the game working
right
now.
Make this stupid thing multi-core.
Yeah.
Get it working properly on servers, and then this wouldn't be an issue. It's not like they're trying to do too much necessarily. They're trying to do too much for their old broken engine.
DayZ is going to modernize Bohemia's engine. Is what's going to happen.
I hope so.
Well, I mean, in DayZ, servers are already 64-bit and multi-threaded. The servers are, not the client yet. And
I don't think the servers are really taking advantage of it, though. It didn't feel like it got that big of a bump when that happened.
Yeah.
It's what took us from 30 players to 50, and it's
still the same lag.
40
though.
To 50.
Right.
Dude, you know,
that's not,
H1Z1
that's not.
Has 200 players a server.
They took all those servers down.
Well, but they
but I'm
have
saying,
a system
200
that
players,
Dave.
Yeah.
200 players day one. And it was laggy, but it's no more crazy laggy than what DayZ is. So give it a couple weeks. That's 200 players.
We'll give it a couple weeks. No, we don't know. Because remember when DayZ launched, they were saying like,
it could,
I think it doesn't work. No big deal. It'll be fixed quickly. And some of it was, and some of it a year later has not been. So
we just know it's not being built on the DayZ engine.
I have more confidence in SOE because they have an engine. They have a tracker
that's
making a massively multiplayer game that works. And they have the resources. So I have more confidence in SOE. But at the same time, let's not... I mean, they also said the game would release in about 4 weeks. Like, how long ago? So... As much as I want to believe that it's coming soon, I don't know. We'll see. But it is now time for the news.
News time!
That's mail time.
Oh, right. Dang it. You looked over me like I was supposed to sing or
something. Well, you're supposed to do something.
Ow, cat. Power to news!
You dumb fat.
John, I was going to fling that cat at just John, like, with Jeremiah, just run on his head, just like, whoosh.
Okay, our first bit of news. Grand Theft Auto 5 has been delayed for the PC. Yay! After being delayed from the console release to January 20-something.
Yeah.
It's now been delayed to, what, March 24th or March 27th? I
think it's. Wouldn't you love to just find out, like, the reason why they do it? Like what bugs?
Consoles.
They said extra polish, they said.
No, they focused on the console releases. PC was back burner, I guarantee it.
Yeah. But it's announced
releasing. Back burner. It doesn't sell as well on the PC.
It doesn't. We don't have to argue about it. But it's releasing now, March 24th, to appease people. They released the system specifications, the recommended specs, and this did make people pretty happy because
it looks pretty low.
It is low. The minimum specs you need: Windows 8.1. You need 64-bit Windows.
Sucks.
Well, no. You need Vista 8.1 or 7. But it has to be 64-bit.
Oh, okay.
Which, it's time we made that.
Yes.
Yeah. Like most people honestly have that.
Most people do.
That game.
If you're still running XP, that's your fault.
Battlefield 4 in 2013 requires 64-bit, too. So.
But the minimum CPU is a Q6600 Intel quad-core, which is a 2.4 gigahertz quad-core, was my first processor. Or an AMD Phenom 9850 quad-core. Both of those are pretty old. Those are like 2007
yeah.
quad-cores. 4 gigs of memory, a NVIDIA 9800 GT or AMD 4870. Those are old cards. And then you need 65 gigs of hard drive space. So the minimum hard drive space is still pretty nasty. The recommended specs aren't even that bad. They recommend you have Windows 7 or Windows 8 or
even. I just uninstall ARMA 3, 180 gigs of mods on more than enough space.
They recommend an Intel Core i5 3470 or AMD FX 8350. So, pretty modern, several-year-old quad or octa-cores. They recommend a 8 gigs of memory, a GTX 660 or AMD 7870, and the same 65 gigabytes of hard drive space. So, even the recommended specs, the potato masher almost meets the recommended specs, and it exceeds
now,
the
minimum. Do you think that's 1080p?
It probably is, yeah. I'm sure it is. I mean, because the game...
What was that specs we were looking at the other day? You're like, hey, you're going to like this, Joel. Like, they started putting... Is it Steam that's going to start putting specs?
It just depends on the publisher.
Oh, okay. But they're starting... That'd be awesome if they actually start pushing that.
The general guideline is, for low minimum settings, expect 720p and 30fps to be the target. For high, expect 1080p, 60fps.
See, I always thought low just meant still 1080p, but just low.
Not at all. No, absolutely not.
Well, and they're a general guideline because the minimum specs, they're all over the map. Like, the two processors they list from AMD and Intel, they're totally different. Like, they have totally different amounts of performance for different things. The video cards have totally different performance. They just have to list something from AMD and something from Intel. They're saying you can play the game if you have at least one of these. But you could even have stuff slower than that, and you could still play the game. Like, you could probably still squeak by. But it runs so well on the PS4 and the Xbox One, it should be very easy to run it on a modern PC. It won't be a big deal, I don't think. Next bit of news. Dave, you almost made me buy a monitor this week.
Again, almost two for two. And
do you want to tell people about this monitor? It's pretty sweet.
I like that everyone I sent it to immediately drooled over it. I got the exact reaction I was hoping.
Well, you convinced me to buy that 4K monitor about like a month and a half ago. I'm very happy with it. But you bought a...
I now regret it because you won't shut up about it.
I just tease you. You're the only one.
That's true.
But now you bought your 1440p monitor, and it's got a pretty good pixel density, right?
Yeah.
Like, you're pretty happy. I mean, it's noticeably more dense than the 1080p display.
Yes.
Even at 27 inches, it's pretty good.
Because the screen's not insanely massive, that resolution looks really nice because, yeah, the pixel density. It's not like retina, but it like kind of feels like half.
Yeah.
Like half that kind of density.
So a lot of people's complaint with 4K is you need to scale your desktop up a lot for it to be usable. I had to upgrade to Windows 8.1 just so I could scale my 4K monitor properly. Like, it's in some programs still
don't scale. Before it was like everything like a dot.
Well, no, on Windows 7 I could scale it up so the 4K monitor looked great, but then my other monitors were matte, like everything on them, was like this big. They were unusable. So it works a lot better on Windows 8.1. But some people are like, well, I don't want a smaller monitor that's 4K. Just give me decent pixel density and make the monitor big so I like can fit everything on there.
Yeah.
So Phillips has made a 4K 40-inch it's not an IPS, but it's basically...
No, it is IPS. It's just IPS. It's like another manufacturer's name for IPS.
Is it 60 hertz?
It's a 60 hertz, dang. 4K, 40-inch panel, $850.
That's the starting price, though. Like, it only goes down from there.
Yeah, $850. And so at 40 inches 4K, that's about the same pixel density as a 27-inch 1440p monitor, isn't it?
And if you want a good... 1440p, like from Dell, it's still going to be almost $600 for a 1440p.
Which those need to drop in. Like, those are making less and less sense to have.
Absolutely, yeah.
But yeah, so for not that much more money, you can upgrade to, I mean, think a 40-inch computer monitor? That's crazy. That's awesome. If those become more of a thing and they start dropping in price, like, I might be on the blind for one of those another year. You know, when they hit, you know, if you think about it, 4K monitors came out a year and a half ago, they were like $3,000. And then they start dropping, then one of them hit $1,000. One of them hit less than that. If this is starting at $850, within a year we could have $500 40-inch 4K monitors.
I mean, I think the most I'm excited about 4K monitors is, like, I don't know, movies. I'm excited to see Lawrence of Arabia in 4K.
I'd love to watch something in 4K on mine. I can't.
I'm talking about TVs. I'm not too jump. I am tempted at some point, maybe down the road, to get the sequel to the iMac 5K thing.
Yeah.
This one I think is going to be a little bit slow, but I think, you know, the next version I think is going to be
the graphics card's really like a 7870 or something, and they're like, you can game at 5K. No,
can't. Yeah, I'm like, maybe you can do. You probably can't even do Minecraft. I can't even do Minecraft at full 1440p. No. But that game is coded like crap.
Yeah.
But anyway,
it's Java.
The thing about 4K though, like our infrastructure in America for the internet has got to improve. If we've got 500 gig caps, where it can barely stream 1080p on Netflix right now, and if you watch Netflix all month, like you're about to hit your cap, what is 4K going to do?
Well, I don't think that needs to upgrade.
It definitely does.
I was reading an article, because you know the new 4K standard's coming out soon?
H265?
Yeah, it's called, it's like the Blu-ray is going to be called Ultra HD Blu-ray. That's what it's called.
Ugh.
I think they should just call it a Blu-ray.
Just 4K. Keep it called Blu-ray. Yeah, like
it should just be Blu-ray 4K or something. I think that would be better. Make it easy to open. Whatever. But the company that's working on the codec, they're working on this insanely high resolution codec that's just streaming only. That's very, very small file size, but the quality's like absolutely insane. But they haven't licensed yet to anyone to use it yet. But they're apparently, people have seen it. They're like, whoa, this is crazy. It's right. Like. Our infrastructure right now, you could stream insanely good 4K stuff on it without having to have like 50 gigs.
Sweet.
So I hope that happens. I think that's going to have to happen rather than just infrastructure.
A lot of things have to happen.
If it stays at the speed it's going right now, it's like we have like 12,000 terabytes.
What needs to happen is competition. Mm-hmm. In most areas, look at any area where Google Fiber has moved in. Every other ISP has stepped their game up, like doubled speeds, increased infrastructure. Like when someone else is there, when Comcast knows you can't go anywhere else, Comcast is not motivated to fix your issues.
I've heard of people in Google Fiber areas getting offers from their cable ISPs for like 200 megabit down for like $40, like as soon as fiber like is available. Dang. Like, hey, by the way, you know, you've been a long-term customer. We like you as a customer a lot. Don't forget about us. Look at our new deals.
You just sell that. You need to be the guy who will be like, hey, you remember us? $50. $50. Oh, okay, $40. And $30, please.
It's actually a scroll. It's a scroll, like flyer.
Well, I've seen the benefit of that. I don't live in an area near Google Fiber, but I have Cox Communications and Verizon Fios, so fiber optic. And when I switched to Fios, I used it for a couple months. I was like, this isn't bad, but it was kind of expensive. So I called them up to like lower some of the stuff down because I didn't need it. And I could tell they were feeling a little desperate on the phone. Like, wait, he doesn't sound happy. He can go somewhere else. Like my apartment's pre-wired for both. It's an easy switch. So they kept giving me stacking loyalty discounts. Now it's $20 cheaper per month for me to have internet and 150 channels of HD. That's $20 cheaper than just having the same internet. Because of all the loyalty discounts after having their internet for three months.
I have a quick funny story to talk about AT&T that's a little bit... It's like that, but opposite, right? Okay, so I went in there. I was trying to see some offers because I think another one of my friend switched over to, I think, Sprint or something like that, and they had a deal that they would kind of buy you out, mm-hmm. and a similar deal. Well, so I went to AT&T going, like, I'm curious... how easy is it for me to just get off the account? If, you know, if they'd be like, hey, well, we run a keep you, maybe they'll give you some deals. I wasn't trying to game the system because I was honestly wanting to get out too, like at the time. Well, I started going through it, and it was great because the lady was super nice, but it was like they weren't like, oh, we want to keep you. They were just, they were so happy to get rid of me.
Because you use so much data, they're like, oh, he uses 30 gigs a month for that. He's letting
me go. It was just funny though because it was just like, I was like, do you guys want me? Like, I mean, I don't have to leave. Do you guys ever watch New Girl?
Yeah.
Have you seen any of the recent episodes?
Yeah. No.
You see the one, I think Jess is like, okay, see you guys, or something like that. She's like closing the door. You guys still don't want me at your party? Okay. And it's like, I'm actually leaving. Oh, man. Like, she's like hoping they all go, oh, no, come back. I felt like it was that scenario. I was like, okay, I'm going to stay. Like, dang you all.
You called my bluff.
Yeah, I was like, dang. Fold.
All right, next bit of news.
I've got two twos.
Do you remember when Microsoft dropped the price of Xbox One temporarily over the holidays to $350? Well, it outsold the PS4, and a lot of people, us included, were saying, yeah, that's going to be a permanent price drop. Like, once they get the taste of hardware sales, they're not going to give those up.
Well,
they did give it up, and they went back to $400. For two whole weeks, the Xbox One is back to $350.
If you buy it during those two weeks, don't you feel like,
whoa, people are not buying this thing.
And it's like, oh, wait, they only want it because it's cheap.
Yeah, if you bought it during the 2 weeks, I hope you probably feel really dumb.
Yeah, the official price is back to $350. And to sweeten the deal on Sony's side, they're now offering The Last of Us as a bundle with, it's probably a download code, but bundled in with every PlayStation 4. So it's still $400. They haven't dropped the price yet, but they've effectively added.
They shouldn't drop. If I was them,
They don't need to. They're still selling it.
Drop the price. Because I think the one bad thing that Xbox... I mean, it's a good thing that they dropped it because I think $500 is a ridiculous...
Well, no one was buying it, so...
Yeah, that was a bad price. But, like, yeah, Sony, as soon as they drop it, people are going to be like, oh, well, if it goes back up, I'll just wait until it goes back to $350 or whatever it is. That's a good solid... $400 is a solid price for that machine.
It was a good price when they picked it, and they're smart to stick to it.
Yeah.
And they shouldn't drop it until they're ready to do, like, the $300 console that comes with a terabyte hard drive. You know, they're like... Really ups the stuff, so. Alright, last bit of news. MSI has a new gaming laptop. We love talking about high-powered graphics cards and things on here. Joel's favorite. The MSI... Now, and the great thing about all gaming PCs is the clever names they give them to make them memorable. The MSI GT72 2QE...
What the crap?
I'm not done.
Start reading.
The MSI GT72 2QE Dominator... I'm not done. Pro.
No freaking way.
Fired.
That's fired.
Pro domination.
It is
to
the max. It is over.
My job is to dominate.
It's like the job.
Well, the specs do dominate, and if you're a pro something, I don't know what type of pro wants this, but if you're a pro something. Okay, so it has a 17-inch screen. It weighs more than 8 pounds. So you're already at like 3 ultrabooks.
That doesn't faze me at all because my last full size laptop weighed 12 pounds.
So well, I good just... for you. But most people don't want that.
No one wants that.
It has an i7-4710 processor, 2.5 base clock, jumps to 3.5 gigahertz, and it is hyper threaded. So it's a 4 gigahertz and hyper threaded mobile processor. It has a GTX 9.
Hyper threaded.
It does dominate.
If you want to do actual, I feel so dominated right now. Okay. If you want to do actual work with it, Joel, that does make a difference. So it has a GeForce GTX 980M. The GPU is the same one that powers the desktop GTX 980. But in mobile version, some of the resources are trimmed down. It has 8 gigs of graphics memory. Which is stupid because no 1080p game, like... There's just not enough pixels at 1080p to use.
External monitors, though.
Yes.
But can they utilize that in a different way? Because doesn't the PS4 have, like, it's got, like, shared, you know?
That's unified memory. It uses an APU. Oh. It's a totally different architecture.
Stand correct?
I wasn't trying to
back it off. Back it off.
You asked, is it
no, like I was backing off in a very friendly manner, like, okay. Oh, back it off.
All right.
I didn't do that very well.
All right, anyway.
Back it off for now.
It can be configured up to 32 gigs of memory, of system memory. Okay, now storage is where it gets interesting. Now, you're familiar with RAID, right, Joel?
Like RAID?
Like running two disks in
RAID?
Yeah,
okay.
All right, well, these disks run in Super RAID 3.
Super Raid Pro 3?
There are as many as four SSDs can be put into this laptop.
Oh my gosh.
And configured into an array. So the test model that PC Gamer got had four 250 gigabyte SSDs.
Dave's rubbing his hands here.
It's in a 1 terabyte striped array, which gives you 1 gigabyte per second read and write speeds in a laptop. In case you're wondering, what do I need this for? Nothing right now.
Well, no, Joel.
I'm copying over my Steam files so fast.
Joel,
I can verify a game a second.
Joel, with 1 gig of transfer per second, you can install our ARMA 3 mod pack in only 10 minutes.
You still have to wait while it unzips everything.
20 minutes.
So, Joel, it has 4 internal SSDs. Can you make that zipping noise again? All right, it has 4.
Thank you, Jesse.
It has 4 internal SSDs. It also has an internal 1 terabyte mechanical storage drive. So 5 internal drives on a laptop.
How big is this laptop?
17 inch over 8 pounds.
Oh my, 17 inch? Jeez.
It has a 230 watt AC adapter.
Joel, are you going to drink that? Be honest.
Debbie wants to drink, and she doesn't want you to waste
it. I don't
want to
get up.
No, I'm going to drink. I'm drinking it.
No, you're not.
Joel,
sipped it for over an
be
hour.
A man, for once.
Okay. Joel says he's a man all the time. We got to go through the rest of the features. Okay, it has a Blu-ray writer, 2.1 channel speakers. The 0.1 means there's a subwoofer somewhere in this thing. Up to 7.1 channel output if you use the optical out. Blah, blah, blah. It has a wireless AC internet. It has a SteelSeries keyboard. I think it's a mechanical. No, this one does have chiclet keys. Although there was a recent gaming laptop. I forget who made it. Maybe it was MSI, but it has a mechanical keyboard.
That keyboard inset is deep, though. Like that.
Yeah, that's stupid.
That laptop is like the size of a hardcover book.
It'd be awesome if you have a laptop. You like reach your fingers down into it, and they like, go really far. You're like, what the?
But it has 2 mini DisplayPort outputs, HDMI, AC power.
Quick
sand. 4 USB 3 ports, 2 more on the other side, so 6 USB 3 ports. That's more than my desktop.
That's pretty good, actually. That's a useful thing for a laptop, a lot of
Joel,
good USB
yeah.
ports.
All of that, how much do you think that costs?
Man, it could go either way, but I'm going to guess...
$2,000. Potato measure price, $350.
It's over $3,000.
Holy crap.
Now, here's interesting. It's interesting you mentioned the potato masher, because you know, you don't...
I mentioned it. Don't look at Joel.
You don't get as much for your money with a laptop as you do with a desktop, right? Well, on Metro Last Light, on very high settings, PC Gamer reported an average frame rate of 64 FPS.
On what?
On Metro Last Light, yeah. On very high settings at 1080p. Average 64 FPS, which is good.
Yeah.
It's interesting because I'm currently testing Metro 2033 and Last Light for the Potato Masher. The average frame rate on the Potato Masher was somewhere in the 70s. So
why would you want to buy that freaking laptop?
I don't know. Well, because that's the thing, is they have a lot of impressive specs.
And if that laptop was like if that was like in the slim size of a MacBook Air,
right.
Like, dang, that's awesome.
Well, if they,
that's a lot of power.
If they drove, like the thing is, they've got a lot of specs that don't help them that cost money. 8 gigs of graphics memory are totally unnecessary. They could go down to 3 or 4 and they'd be fine. 32 gigs of memory, if you want it, you want it, fine. But they could easily go down to 16. I mean, you can get it with 16. The 4 SSDs striped, I don't know why you need that type of performance in a laptop. Like, I don't know who this thing is marketed to. But if you want it, you can get it for a little over $3,000. You can buy it from places like exoticpc.com.
Ooh. If you ever bought one of those and not a PS4, I would hit you.
How angry would you be? Like,
I'd be very angry. Like,
well, Dave, if you bought one of those,
oh my gosh, a PS4 is $400, and you buy a $3,000
PC laptop, Dave, if you bought one of those instead of like a newer car, I'd be upset. I mean, that's car money.
Yeah,
that's Dave car money at least.
Well, no, yeah. I mean, like, you have a couple like about 10-year-old Japanese cars. You can get probably an 8-year-old Japanese car for $3,000. Why wouldn't you?
Or an 8-pound laptop.
Or a couple suppressors.
What the heck is that? Maybe just show me some gif of some guy swimming across the screen. I can't tell if it's DayZ or ARMA or something.
I want it to be DayZ. I know.
I think it's DayZ, actually.
Is it really?
Holy crap, it's someone swimming across.
It's ARMA.
Oh, ARMA.
It's in Shenaris, though, yeah. Thank you, Debbie, for participating in the podcast.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Okay. It is now time for mail time.
Mail time!
You can write into the podcast at casualshenanigans@gmail.com. Just like Justin did. And his the subject of his email is
something on blue time!
Quotes Joel's singing voice. He says, "Ahoy, hoy, podcasters. I have a question regarding monitors. I currently have the stock standard. This one will do 24-inch Asus monitor. While it works fine, it does the job and look good. I'm running an R9-290X, 12-gigabit SSD. I'm thinking it's 120-gigabyte SSD. And an i7-3770K. I'm not really getting my money's worth from it, seeing as I only get 60 FPS with my current monitor, and an R9-290X is well capable of doing over that. He's looking to upgrade. It's unlikely I'd be interested in 4K gaming at this stage, and I don't use 3D, so those two features aren't important. Other than that, I guess I'm asking you to sell me a monitor. My price range is mid to higher end, so I guess up to $800 Australian, which means about a disappointing $650 US.
That's a good range.
He wants to change to 120Hz, but he's curious, is it worth going up to 144Hz? The way he sees it is 4K is on its way to us, but it's not viable as a cheapish option in the near future, so something new is needed in the meantime. Thanks from Australia, where, yes, I literally do drive right past kangaroos pretty much every day, and there's the odd koala in the trees around where I live. Luckily, I haven't had any drop bear problems lately, though. So until that day, is that when they drop out of trees on you?
You haven't heard of drop bears?
No.
No.
You wait, you guys don't
know. I don't want to live on this world anymore.
You guys don't know about drop bears.
Tell us more about drop bears.
Is it just what it sounds like, where bears drop on you out of things?
Because that sounds adorable.
No, it's
koalas.
It's where vicious, oh gosh, what is it? It's where honey badger-like bears drop out of trees on you and maul you. Drop bears.
Really?
Wow. I don't want to live anymore.
He hasn't
had any drop bear problems.
But drop bears are also a completely made-up animal that Australians use to troll people on the internet.
Gotcha. Oh. Yours truly, Justin.
So it's not a real thing.
No,
drop bears are not real.
Okay. Well, I mean, like, I know honey badgers are real, and they're kind of crazy, so maybe they could be.
Until the day comes where I'm passed on and get out alive, I shall continue enjoying your gaming podcast. Okay.
Full-size grizzly bears. Sorry, I'm still on that.
Jumping out of trees in Australia.
Could you imagine, like, just straight
up? No, don't I imagine, because that sounds like hell.
Body slamming you.
Imagine grizzly bears with wings.
That's awesome. That's going to my board game.
Says someone who bears stays indoors a lot. Bears with wings.
I'm not putting that
instead
in my game.
Instead of the nebula or instead of the dragon.
No, yeah, but like bears he with just dragon finally wings. He just finally made it out of the nebula. Whoops! A bear with wings drags you back
in space. Bears with wings in space.
A bear with a unicorn horn.
Unibear.
Unibear.
No, the flying bear.
A pega bear.
Did John go to sleep?
I think so.
Cool. All right. So he wants us to sell him a monitor. He wants at least 120Hz. So, Dave, what are your initial thoughts?
So the 120 versus 144, I mean, I'm still stuck at 60 like a peasant. But it depends on the games you play. There's certain games, like if all you do is CSGO, sure, go for the 144. You will see a difference.
Right.
But if you're playing like Tomb Raider and, you know, ports like GTA 5, I don't think you really need 144, or maybe even not even 120Hz. And the problem is going to be driving that frame rate too. I think it's going to be more difficult to drive 144Hz than 4K.
Yeah, and then, but fortunately, even if you're at 100, like you can set 144Hz, you can run it at 120 and stuff.
Exactly.
So,
yeah.
Now, so here, Justin, here's where you have to make a decision. If you want a large size, if you want high density, like, you have to decide where your priorities are at. I have four possible monitors picked out. I'm going to run you through them real quick, and you can decide what you think is the best. And, Debbie, remind me to email all these to myself afterwards so I can include them in a link. Justin, I'll reply to your email. That's what I'll do. Okay, so first we have an Asus. It's a 24-inch LED monitor, 144Hz refresh rate, 1 millisecond response time. It is 3D capable. But, yeah, it's a 24-inch 1080p 144Hz monitor. It's $265.
Do you guys remember when 3D was a thing?
Yeah. Now,
I remember that 2 month
period. It'll be back in 2016 when Avatar 2 comes out.
Now, Justin, if you want a larger monitor, BenQ makes a really nice LED gaming monitor. It's also 1080p, 144Hz. It's $450 and it's 27 inches. Now, personally, I think 1080p at 27 inches is a little bit too low pixel density for it to look good. So I wouldn't personally do that. Now, if you want 144 hertz, 1440p, 27 inches, first of all, your R9-290X is not fast enough to run most games at 144 hertz, 1440p. But that monitor exists, and it's called the Asus ROG Swift, and you can't afford it because it's $900 US. But it's 27 inches, 1440p. It has G-Sync. I'm running.
Here's another option you can't afford.
That's the first one you can't afford. It's 27 inches, 1440p, 144 hertz, G-Sync. So it's a really nice monitor. The nice thing about this is...
Isn't the G-Sync like help make it look a lot better even at 30 FPS?
Exactly. It's G-Sync, if you don't know, it syncs... Well, G-Sync doesn't matter for him because he has an AMD card. But G-Sync... It syncs. Well, there's a AMD that does
free. Basically, sync. Whoever this dude is, you suck.
No,
you have the crappiest thing.
I have an R9-290. My rig is slower than his, and I'm happy. FreeSync is AMD's standard, and it works the same way. But like, say your game can only manage 40 FPS. Well, it sets the monitor's refresh rate to 40 FPS, so it's gonna feel like that smooth 30 FPS locked or 60 FPS locked feeling. Even if you're running at slower speeds.
I was trying to see what actually 40 FPS looks like without the V-Sync. Like,
people say G-Sync is game-changing, is what most people describe it as.
Because it's like, yeah, if it can only run at like 41 or whatever, I'll take 41 block, whatever that is.
Right. Now, so that's $900. Now, here's another, my last option is that we do, those of us on the podcast here, we do a lot of graphics and video and web work. So good colors are really important to us. So we actually prioritize refresh rates lower than other things. We have IPS monitors for the most part, in-plane switching, which they can't go any faster than about 60 hertz because of the technology. Some QNX, I think, makes an overclockable one that can hit like 96 hertz. But for $435, Asus makes a 1440p 27-inch monitor that's IPS. And IPS basically just means the colors... It's going to look gorgeous. Even though the resolution isn't any higher than the others, it's going to look amazing. But you are going to be stuck at 60 hertz. So if you want a really fast refresh rate, keep in mind that your 290X is not going to be able to run most games on like ultra settings at 144 hertz. That's super fast. So if you're playing like CSGO or something, yeah, you're probably fine. But if you want to play like, you're not going to be playing Assassin's Creed Unity at 144 hertz. Like, it's just not going to happen. So
20 years from now, people won't be playing Unity.
So, Justin, if you want anything more than 30. I'm going to send these consoles to you. Or I'm going to send these monitors to you. monitors to you. If you can let us know what games you really want to play, I can narrow this list down a little bit for you. I can
tell you how you won't be playing.
All right. But, yeah, anyway, Justin, I'll send you those monitors and write back to me if you need more help. All right, Brett wrote in and said, hey guys, big fan
Brett
of the podcast.
Brett. Okay, it sounded like you said Breck. I was like, that's a weird name.
Hey guys, big fan of the podcast. Love listening to it while I push carts at work, even though my manager keeps bitching at me for it. And I'm long drives back to school. Glad we can help you get in trouble at work. I never played PC games until I heard about some ARMA mod called DayZ and started researching it. Several Evil Viking 13 videos later, I was buying the game myself. Since then, I've
become... You and me, Bohemia, like... 25 cents, maybe.
Anything? Since then, I've become much more of a PC gamer, even though I still play my evil consoles a good amount. Really, it's like they have joint custody over me. 1 week with Mama PS4 and her new... 1 week with Mama PS4 and her new boyfriend, Joel, and the next week with PC and angry Uncle Jeremiah.
That's amazing!
Angry big Uncle Jeremiah.
What is that relevant? Right now, I'm playing my Alienware 14 laptop, as it's the best solution for a gaming computer since I'm a very mobile college student. It has 8 gigabytes of RAM, an Intel Core i7-4700MQ, 1 terabyte hard drive, and a GeForce GT750M.
Oh, specs.
Joel, sorry, all you know, yes, it can run on the lowest settings at 30 FPS. I know that's all you care about. Alright, it gets pretty good performance for a laptop, but I'd like to grow as a PC gamer and build my own PC. At this point in the email, David and Jeremiah are salivating at their keyboards. What's the best possible build I can get for $700? I would need literally everything outside a copy of Windows. I'd be playing anything and everything on it, so load me up. However, I wouldn't be building this all at once. I'd probably be buying these parts over the course of the next 5 to 6 months. Thanks for taking the time to read my email. Please enjoy this video of seals slapping each other. And he sent a video of seals just slapping each other on the beach.
That's a
awesome. Okay, Brett. So you say you need everything. So you need a monitor, you need a mouse and keyboard, you need speakers or a headset. Like, you need the whole
thing. Well, package. He uses TV with an HDMI cable for the PC.
Well, I've got a $698 build I'm going to pitch to Brett.
Jeremiah's like, whoa, wait, no.
And as usual, Brett, right back in, if you can go like, oh, wait, I can use this, I can do this different, I can do this different. Like, if you hear this list and go, oh, well, I don't need that, let us know, and we will get you the most performance for your money. It also helps that you have 6 months to buy parts, so you can get really good deals, yeah. And you can get better stuff from this. So this is a $700 build, but I expect that you can get better than this. You can get a
really good computer for $700.
Well, basically, it's a potato masher, all new parts, a few of them slightly better. Except I'm realizing I didn't include a hard drive.
It's got to be way better than the potato masher.
The potato masher is really good. But no, better. Like, it has to include a monitor, and it has to include mouse and keyboard, and a headset. Right. So okay. It's a couple hundred bucks of extra stuff.
So it is, I guess it's not going to be. Yeah. It's just the base piece.
I forgot to include a hard drive, so I'm going to have to hit this again. But
you like click. Aww.
But I know this is doable in this budget. I put in an Intel G3258 3.2 gigahertz dual core. You might recognize this processor. Listen to this as a podcast. For the several hundred comments on Reddit telling me that all our choices for the potato masher were wrong and we should use this processor. For $66, it is like the best bang for your buck for gaming. It's a dual core 3.2 gigahertz processor that can overclock to like 4.5 gigahertz. It includes a Hyper 212 air cooler.
Now, I'm going to pause you for a second. So you're recommending a dual core?
Well, I'm going to get to that. Let me get through it, and then okay. I'm circling back. These are all brand new parts.
Fight.
No, there's no fight. There's no fight.
Dave's well, not... I see one. It's fine.
I'm glad I didn't look
what
back
at my like, days. What do you want to happen?
It's horrible.
Like, Jules, Jules.
All my friends to fight in the gladiator race.
Joel's in the stands, war blind! Appease me!
Wait, isn't that like one of your family members? Oh! Kill him last! Alright.
Make it fast!
It has an Asus Micro ATX motherboard, nothing special. You should be able to get a decent overclock out of it.
Yep.
8 gigabytes of crucial memory, a GTX 660 graphics card, a Cooler Master Min Tower case, a Corsair 600 watt power supply, an Asus DVD burner. A 22-inch Acer IPS 1080p display.
That's not bad.
A Cooler Master Devastator gaming keyboard with mouse. And a Logitech G430 gaming headset. Okay, so that comes up to $700. You'll notice there's no hard drive.
It's more the way you look at me when you say that. Seduction.
No one calls their gaming part seduction.
No, the way you say it, like you're trying to seduce me with your words.
Joel, I don't seduce you with my words. I don't need words. So anyway, not Justin. Hold on, Brett. Sorry. When I send you this, I'm going to email you back with a link to this build. I'm going to change a few parts so I can include a hard drive. But what I want to say is, since you can buy this over the course of a couple months, I would recommend considering a used part or two. If you buy anything used, buy the graphics card used, because you can probably get an R9 7950 or a GTX 670, a card that's really only a year or two old, used from a place you can even get it with a warranty, and you will save the most money there.
Yeah.
I just totally realized something. R9, what was the name of it? What was the name of the video card?
Well, the one in here is a GTX 660.
No, which one you just said? R9 70 something.
The HD 7950.
No, it was an R something.
R9 290?
The R stands for Radeon, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I said just figured out.
Thanks for the show.
Like, why is the R in there? I'm like, why the heck? Because I don't know. I would say like a Radeon R9 something like that. I'm like, wait, that stands for Radeon.
Okay, so Dave, here's my thing with dual core. If he's okay buying used, I would say no. Don't get a dual core. Get something like we did. Get an i5 750. If he wants to buy this all new, that's totally understandable. Mm. The best option in his price range is a 750. Is a G3 3258. Each core is faster than our i5 750 for gaming, and you can overclock it quite a long ways. Now, there is the chance in the next couple years, more cores are going to be needed for gaming. So, Brett, what you want to consider, if you have 5 or 6 months, maybe save up a little more money and bump up to like an FX 6300 It's a 6-core AMD processor. They also just released the FX8150, which is an 8-core, $120 processor. You'll need to overclock it to get really awesome gaming performance in like DayZ or ARMA 3 if you want to play those. But since most gaming is not really limited by the CPU, that would be a good way to future-proof yourself. And if you wanted to do that, we would just need to be a little more careful about a couple other parts. So, Brett, I expect you to write us back when you can let us know like more of what you plan on buying and stuff. And we'll help you narrow it down a little more. Also, if you wait for deals, you can get that case for cheaper. You don't have to spend $65 on a power supply. Like, we can get all this for cheaper.
Actually, I want to revisit the dual core versus quad core thing.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
I definitely have reservations about recommending a dual core, especially 6 months from now. We've already had a case with Far Cry 4 where dual cores would not launch the game.
Right.
Now, that was more of probably a coding limitation where they had multi-threaded something, and just for compatibility, they just locked it to quad cores and higher just so they can avoid trying to support dual cores. There's actually a patch you can get from like one of the pirating groups that fixes that. Mm-hmm. It doesn't run well on a dual core, but it'll run. But officially, Far Cry 4 will not run on a dual core. And I think we're going to see more of that.
Unofficially, it won't run well on most things.
No, but just Joel,
actually. But you're right. I think we're probably going to see that more in the future. So, Brett, I'm recommending this now because for your budget, it's the most balanced way to do it. But if you can stretch your budget at all, if you're okay buying used, you can get pretty decent quad cores used for that money. Or if you can push your budget just a little bit, you can get... Well, I mean, I say push it a little bit. We could save some money in a few other areas, possibly. And you could get, like, an FX6300 hexa-core or something. Like,
yes.
We can make something work. So write us back. Let us know what you need. And then... Last bit of mail is from Ben. Ben, who played DayZ with us the other night. Hey, guys. Two things this week. First, I wanted to say thanks for the build advice. We gave him build advice on a computer like a month or two ago. The computer turned out awesome. I've been playing tons of games like Crysis 3, Far Cry 4, ARMA 3, Watch Dogs, Skyrim with like 250 mods.
Yeah.
And a bunch of others already at ultra 60 FPS. He's been downscaling from 2704 by 1521 to 1080p. He says, I know that's an odd starting resolution, but it's working great. So, hey, more power to you. I'm guessing he's using, like, NVIDIA Dynamic Super Resolution or Virtual Super Resolution.
I bet Skyrim would look really, really nice with that.
Dude, I bet. I just wanted to say I'd highly recommend this build to anyone. I don't remember what build we recommended for you, Ben, so...
we're glad that you paid money and it worked.
Yeah, we're glad it worked.
When was the last time we did recommend a specific build?
Pretty much, like, every single week. I just did it, like, 5 minutes ago.
I know that.
Twice.
I really do phase out during this. Okay, that
makes sense. Joel, just finish it.
I've got
it.
A little time drop.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's a drop.
It's good. It's not that. I'm not afraid of it or nothing. I'm like, oh, guys, a little bit more.
I can get you more.
I'm just full. I ate an entire thing of
Okay. Ben has his real questions. You guys argue, like, with text messages or something quiet. I realize this isn't exactly PC gaming related. If you just want to email me back, that's fine. We're going to talk about it on here. This is kind of directed to all of you who run a YouTube channel. I'm starting a YouTube channel, and I was hoping to get advice.
This is for Joel, basically.
I don't want to go too in-depth, but the most comparable thing to what my content will be is movie reviews. It's not movie reviews, but that's the easiest comparison I'm going to get. So he's not doing movie reviews. He's doing reviews of something like movies, like that style of review. I'm most likely going to be editing with Premiere, what I've experienced with, and probably recording the audio with Audacity. I'm currently making some videos, and I hope to launch the channel in a month, and I'd like to have a few videos to start with and kind of have a style nailed down. I already have the YouTube channel, Twitter handle, Instagram, Pinterest, and a domain for the channel. I also have a sister who's a graphic designer, so she's helping me with some of the channel website art and logos. I have family that run decently successful blogs, so I'm getting some advice from them, but I'm hoping to get more specific advice for YouTube channels. So here's some of the questions I have. 1. Can you see any foreseeable problems with the two programs I listed for recording and editing? Any specific suggestions? I think we pretty easily say Premiere's fine. I mean, Premiere, like, pros use it to edit movies. If you're comfortable using Premiere, you're totally fine.
Yeah.
And Audacity for audio recording is also totally fine. I've actually, up until very recently, I've been doing most of the... podcast audio editing in Audacity. Joel's just texting profanity to Debbie. Whatever. Okay. So Dave, here's the next question. What is the best way to reach my target audience? I know things like Reddit view self-promotion as a big negative. I want to figure out how to get my channel out there to the largest audience possible.
If you have an established Reddit account and you contribute to certain communities, maybe post some of your videos there, but that's not something that you want to do very regularly. Maybe if you have a Keystone video. But yeah, in general, don't expect anything that you post on Reddit to do well at all. Be surprised if it does, but don't ever expect it.
Reddit's not
what
a dumping
Keystone video. What are you talking
like
about?
Like the Potato Masher. Like that was a video that was like the cornerstone of the last couple
for
months.
For a second,
of
I thought you guys were
channel.
Talking about the term like turnkey.
Oh, okay, no.
So I was
no,
like Keystone video. I was like, what is that?
Yeah, like if Jeremiah like,
turnkey video solutions.
If, yeah, no, that, I mean that video is definitely kind of like a kind of like when I put
a milestone
like, joystick
video.
Versus keyboard. See all the hatred. I was like, yes, let's beat on it.
Yeah, if Jeremiah was posting like every Tropico video to Reddit, that would not go over well.
There are people who do it in the Tropico subreddit. It's clogged. People going, look, I'm starting the campaign. Watch me play through the campaign. It's like, no.
I can do that.
You mean the thing that only has two outcomes? Do it exactly like this or fail?
Dude,
no
our
thanks.
Facebook, Twitter generation, man. People are like, because someone enjoyed watching someone, that means everyone will enjoy me too.
Yeah, the thing with Reddit is like, if you can provide a value, even if the value is just 5 seconds of that someone will laugh at, Reddit will like it for the most part. If you just want people to watch your content because you want them to like it and it's not something they're instantly going to enjoy, Reddit will hate it and Reddit will crap on you really hard. The best way to reach your target audience, Dave, I guess, I don't know if you would agree with me, we've both been doing our channels for like three plus years now.
Mm-hmm.
Be good for a long time consistently. And we have both broken that rule a couple times. But, you know,
and network.
Yeah, network. But don't take it too seriously. Like, try to be as good as possible, as long as possible. And it's going to take a long time and persistence. But, I mean, some video series each of us made just because they were fun and we wanted to do it. And we wanted to share it with the 5 people who thought it was interesting. Neither of us are looking at this like, this is what my retirement right here.
YouTubes.
After I get famous. Like, neither of us moved to L.A., if you understand, the, you know, the
similar. So, question. When will you end this?
And it's not fun anymore.
Yeah, and that's actually the advice I'm about to give, Joel, is my best advice for doing YouTube is only post content that you're proud of and that you actually enjoy creating, and as soon as you stop enjoying the creation process, stop posting stuff.
Yeah.
Because people are going to see it in your work. If you stop enjoying it and you're just cranking crap out just because you're getting 1,000 views or something like that, people are going to know.
Yeah. And if you're posting something that you're proud of and you enjoy it, not a lot of other people do, that's also fine. Like, if this has to be a big success, then no, that's not the smart way to do it. But if your goal is to be a giant success, then we're not probably the right people to ask, because both Dave and I have passed on many marvelous opportunities to clip.
Hey, I don't know about you guys' YouTube channels, but mine's doing just fine.
But both me and Dave have passed on a lot of marvelous opportunities to be cheap and get a little farther ahead than we are now, and we've passed on it.
I was successful with the first part of that. Being cheap.
But we've passed on it because we're not, like, we don't really make any significant amount of money off of it, and it's mostly for fun. It's a hobby. It's something we'd be playing the games anyway. Like, it's not, it's something we enjoy, and when, you know, like, when I go through busy periods of life and I don't have time to post, I don't. Like, when, you know, if I'm in the middle of wedding season or something, I slow down posting for a month or two, and it's not a big deal. Like, I don't care if...
Well, I still give you a hard time.
Yeah, you do, but I don't care if people expect videos in a certain amount of time. I have a life. Like, they can get over it. You know, like, people don't... I don't owe them anything because, like, they're not... They don't pay me money unless you're a Patreon subscriber to the podcast.
I feel like I gotta stop this. I feel like we've been talking too much about YouTube advice. Like, this just kind of makes me depressed.
He asked for YouTube advice.
We're talking about YouTube advice.
He asked for YouTube advice. What's depressing about that? Billions of dollars go through YouTube every year.
I mean, it's a sad world.
It's just a guy who's making a movie. What's the difference?
Joel, you make billions in, like, selling
It's not the silver screen! It's not the silver screen!
No, I'm not talking...
Hey, there are Joel. Kids in dorm rooms in college making millions of dollars a year
and
on
I
YouTube.
Hate them.
Oh.
Hey, Joel. Yeah. What year did you start posting videos to your YouTube channel?
2005?
And when was the last time you posted a video to your YouTube channel?
2006?
Joel?
Not true.
Joel, when was the last time you posted a video?
Oh, I have no idea. I don't
Maybe 2014? Early 2014?
No, like 4 weeks ago.
Oh, really?
Wait, what was it?
Last of Us.
Yeah.
Oh, I kind of forget that it posts to YouTube.
Okay. Anyway, so that's our best advice is like,
you hate yourself?
you want to have good thumbnails.
I don't post it for anyone. I post it for you guys because I can't share
it anywhere.
I can't share it anywhere else.
Post it for yourself.
PS4 doesn't allow me to.
Post stuff that you like, even if you're just sharing with friends that you like and that your friends might like. And then if it blows up from there, be happy about that.
But yeah, if you're expecting to be successful, you're going to have to do it for a very long time, and you're going to have to be good for a long time, and only five people want to look at your stuff and watch it. And that's just kind of the nature of the business. It gets harder and harder every year. So I guess I can't speak for Dave. I'm not expecting to become a big success doing this. I'm not at all interested in that. The amount of time versus the amount of like money that I get out of YouTube, I'd be better off doing like any other way I make money. It makes way more money per hour than YouTube. But YouTube is a ton of fun. So that's why I'm doing it.
Speak for yourself, Jeremiah. One of us has been to London. Once, briefly.
Shilling for Battlefield 4 on the Xbox One, you peasant.
You are. No, guys, I'm totally good with the controllers.
Dave, how
I watched
much
that video.
Sightseeing did you
I watched
see
that
though?
Video of Dave standing there for hours on end looking so happy. He was so excited to be there.
It's a fun experience. And that's the thing. Is like you can have plenty of fun experiences that don't really benefit you necessarily in the long run. But if you enjoyed it, that is a benefit. Like if you have fun,
I enjoyed
doing
watching
it.
The video hoping to see Dave, and we never got to see him.
But Ben, if you want to send, like before you launch, if you want to send us any links to unlisted videos or something, we'll happily like give you some critiques or something. Like privately, we'll email you back if you're curious. But neither Dave or I are like YouTube experts or anything. I mean, Dave is obviously his channel is a lot more successful than mine, but
so I know the YouTube is total war.
But neither of us would claim to be like
your video's not good
masters
Civil
at YouTube.
War soldiers.
But then last questions: any specific recommendations for the videos? What format, video, audio codec, etc. to maximize the quality on YouTube? I'll be using some source footage ranging from 720p to 1080p. Render at the highest resolution any of your footage is. The other stuff will upscale well enough for YouTube.
Yep.
Render for 1080p, render at least like 20 to 25 megabit per second.
Yep.
Depending on internet speed. Pretty much any format YouTube will accept, so render whatever works for you. But just do a couple test renders. Render like 30 seconds at a time of like maybe an MOV, an H.264. Like see what your computer can render in a decent amount of time and see what works well on YouTube. Both Dave and I have good success with AVC MP4s around 25 megabit per second for 1080p, and then for big videos we upscale them to 1440p or render at 1440p
or 4K.
Sometimes 4K, not because the source quality gets really any better, but because YouTube, when it sees that resolution, will let you play the video at a higher bit rate, and mm-hmm. it ends up looking a lot better because of that.
Does it look better at 1080p?
Well, here's the thing: if you have a 1080p display, you watch 1080p on YouTube, it'll be like 3.5 to 5 megabit per second. If you watch the 1440p version, it still is on a 1080p screen, but it'll be like 10 megabit per second, so it'll actually look good. 7? I thought it was like 10.
No, it's not that much more. It's like 7 or 8, yeah.
It's a noticeable bumping quality. It's not insane, but like, so it just lets you have more options, basically.
I like that Dave rendered like a massive 19 gig H1Z1 file. It's like, does it matter?
No, that was an accident. It was supposed to be 26 megabit.
He rendered it better than Blu-ray bitrate.
H1, like...
All right, so anyway, that's the mail time. Thank you for writing in, guys. I'll be emailing you with links to stuff afterwards. Joel, it's now time for 90 Seconds with You, a part of the podcast where you do whatever you want for as long as you want.
Well, we're all here in person, so that really
You had something written down for your 90 seconds.
Pillow fight!
No. Nope, that's not it.
All you can hear is
Debbie is running back into the room. She's excited.
Okay, can you read off?
Wait,
oh,
me too.
Johnny woke up!
I didn't go to sleep. I didn't.
Oh, man, I'm sorry.
Okay.
I think I'm doing
it. Is it raining?
No, it's the air.
Oh, it's air?
Yeah.
Okay, Joel, focus. Okay. Focus. It's your segment.
Oh, what is that? Huh?
No, Joel, focus. We're in the middle of something. Jesse, stop distracting you. Sitting here is a privilege.
Okay, read what
Joel's H1Z1 voice.
Okay. I feel really, really bad about this, okay? So
not bad enough to not say it, though.
Yeah, definitely not. I'm not that ashamed.
I'm super ashamed. No, I mean, not that ashamed.
I was
ashamed
of the moment because I felt bad because I continued playing with this kid. Okay, that's sort of...
Joe, get into the context really quickly.
Hurry.
Don't giggle. Stop giggling.
Is that what you said to him, Joel?
I'm just kidding. Hurry.
Go. All right, Joel.
Oh, man.
You're hitting a pedophile quotient for the podcast.
James is on TeamSpeak. I can't find James, but I'm hanging out with the other guys. Another random guy joins our group, and he's like, "Hey guys, are you guys wondering, like, you guys gonna see where all the loot is or whatever?" He's just talking with us. Like, I was like, "Dude, are you talking like Batman?" And I said it all sarcastic like that, and he goes, "Oh, sorry, man. My voice is like this. I got hurt sometime, and I can only speak like this. It's some kind of disease." And I was like, really bad. I was like, "Why are you talking like Batman?" And like,
it's a condition.
He was totally sincere, like straight up, like, "Oh, I'm sorry. Is it bothering you?" I'm like, "It's just how my voice is. I'm sorry." I was like, "Oh, dude, it's all right. I'm sorry." I felt horrible. And then the rest of the night, James was like, "Hey, Joel, remember that time you called someone out saying that sounded like Batman?" I was like, "It's kind of a good thing."
It's better Batman than like a lot of other voices.
Yeah. Yeah, but I just felt, I was like, "You're talking like Batman." "I'm so sorry, man."
All right, it's now time for the comment of the week.
Comments of the week.
Comments? What?
That was actually 90 seconds.
It was about 90 seconds, yeah.
That was the first.
It's now time for comments of the week. We used to time them. The part of the podcast. Joel! Focus!
I'm adding funny stuff to the podcast.
Is that pancakes? Oh, knee slapper!
I'm so entertained.
No, it is pancakes.
He's just out of nowhere eating pancakes. Like, dude, it's freaking 11:45. Like, pancakes. Are they just straight cold?
Cold pancakes.
Who eats cold pancakes?
That's John does, because he doesn't care.
That's pretty good.
Hey, they're not pancakes. They're eggs and bananas smashed together.
Oh, well, that makes more sense.
They're special gluten snowflake pancakes. Love you, John. Okay, so Dave, it's time for your comments of the week.
Comments of the week.
How tolerant and forgiving the internet can be.
Our first comment is one of our first ARMA missions based off of a real life mission based off of Operation Red Wings.
Lone Survivor,
basically. The mission actually went surprisingly well, even though it was like a really old mission and didn't transfer well from the alpha version of ARMA to the final. Except for like Chris's gear never loaded, so we had like all these cool loadouts, like the boonie hats, the SEAL style gear and the guns. But Chris was just like in like tighty whities and like a track suit shirt. So like the whole time, like, we're like running from all the insurgents and trying to get to the helicopters, and like people are dying. It's supposed to be like a serious mission, and Chris is just like naked. Got a comment. The guy in his underwear ruined the immersion.
Like, you're gonna be watching the video going,
it's so real. You know that was you at like 14.
Probably.
That guy would have ruined the immersion.
Or 20.
Or 20, yeah. Or like yesterday.
Imagine Dave 10% less tolerant.
No, I mean, it was worse. Our next comment. I'm gonna actually read the comment first and the title of the video that the comment was posted on. Console aim skill. So boring again. It's not PC. Posted on Awesome Moments in Battlefield Bad Company 2, parentheses, PC. Title of the video.
What the heck?
And as usual, our Total War comments on really old Total
War
videos.
It's like its own special, like, reports from the battlefield, from the battlefront.
Posted, yeah. Posted on episode 1 of Total War.
We need Fife to play right there.
Yeah. That would actually be amazing. So can you whistle for this, actually, for me, just real quick? That's pretty legit.
Cough, okay. Cough, cough.
All that smoke is a young 13-year-old in the war.
So this comment is posted on the first episode of Total War, posted in 2013. And this is written in all caps, so I am just going to yell it.
Oh, gosh.
Stop saying cavalry, you piece of shit! It's cavalry! That's been our comments of the week.
Thank you,
someone's
Dave.
Got a bit of hatred.
As anyone was curious, most of the arguing has died down on the potato rifle video. The only thing we got this week was someone insinuated that the only way to get parts that cheap was if they were stolen. And if I insinuated, he literally said that. So thank you, everyone.
Well, I mean, Jeremiah did sell his body for these parts.
So I didn't, though.
I mean, you gotta do what you gotta do to get the cheap prices.
But thank you, everyone, for listening. As always, thank you for rating us on iTunes. Listen to us there. Thank you for sending an email. We really like it. We like answering your questions. You can follow us at Casual
Joel does it.
We can follow you, or you can follow us. We're not gonna follow you. At Casual Shenanigans on Twitter, at Jeremy.
If you're gonna write into us, write better emails.
Joel, one had your mail time as the subject line, like written out mail time parentheses Joel voice.
The people that's... love you. Don't drive them away.
Love them back, Joel. No, all my hatred drives them closer here. It's like an abusive relationship. Joel. They like what?
Finish it.
Yeah, Joel, before the podcast ends.
Okay, I'll finish the last sip of this.
It's not goat even blood. A sip.
Goat blood.
It's called dragon blood.
It's Viking blood.
Viking blood. It's wine. All right. Anyway.
Are you warm now, Joel?
Feeling toasty.
You can follow us at Casual Shenanigans, at Germ Gaming, at Evil Viking on Twitter. You can write into casualshenanigans @gmail.com. We hope to talk more about H1Z1 in the coming weeks as we play more of it.
Yes!
And because Debbie is our H1Z1 expert, can you take us out this week? That's not the ending of the podcast.
Wait, I wanted to say something about the reviews.
Slap a goat.
Can you say something about the reviews for like a second, please?
Alright.
You guys are in a rush? Oh, you guys are going to leave?
Joel can say that, and then Debbie, you're doing a proper ending. Take it seriously.
Like, what kind of proper ending?
Do you ever listen to the ending of the
podcast? I do, but I don't like it.
Alright, well, after... It's mean?
It's mean.
Stay casual is mean.
Oh, I think it's slap a seal.
That's not the real ending.
It's becoming more popular.
Slap a seal
is better.
Why?
Or because
it's freaking retarded and it's funny and people remember it.
Alright, Joel, talk about the reviews real quick.
I was looking at the podcast and I was like, oh, I wonder if we got any reviews. Because the last time I looked was like over a year and a half ago. And I was like, looking at the reviews, I was like, wow, there's like people that enjoy this podcast. It was just kind of surprising. Like,
you know people do listen to this.
No,
like,
I know that. I know that. I mean, people obviously send emails
Joel,
and want to know about tech
how
crap.
Many people do you think listen to the podcast? Each episode.
At least 12.
All right. Thanks, Joel.
I'm just saying the reviews are pretty cool. I was reading them, I was like... Thanks, people, for enjoying the podcast. It's kind of awesome.
We do appreciate it. We really appreciate that you guys enjoy the podcast.
I wish we start a podcast so I can just review them and be like, you guys are nice people.
All right. I don't feel like your podcast would stay like that for long. Joel just says nice things about you.
I subscribe.
If Joel could make the whole podcast just saying nice things about people for more than one episode, I would love to watch that. All right. Debbie, can you take us out properly?
And as always, folks, stay casual.